My name's Andy Griggs, and on behalf of Drama Stage Qumran, LA Labor Fest, and Public Works Improvisational Theater, If the Shoe Fits, Voices from Solitary Confinement.
All I have is this pen, this paper, and the truth. I write to you as a survivor of torture, soon to experience more, in hopes that you will use my account here as you see fit to shed a light on the use of torture in the United States. My name is Sean Swain, Mansfield Correctional Institute, Ohio.
My name is J.R.F. within a cage. How can you lock me in a cage, within a cage, for some misdeed done within a cage? All you do is feed my rage. You can't teach me anything good within a cage, except that monsters control the locks, and in terror I have lost the keys within a cage. I plead, I pray, but it simply gets worse every day within a cage. Animosity worsens, empathy is lost, and the days turn into days within a cage.
Solitary confinement is the practice of isolating inmates in closed cells for 22 to 24 hours a day, virtually free of human contact, for periods of time ranging from days to decades. In Oregon, long-term isolation units are called intensive management units, IMUs. In Pennsylvania, they are called restrictive housing units, or HUs. In California and New York, they are security housing units, or SHUs. California and other states also use another euphemism, administrative segregation. Despite the variety of names, the general practice of incarceration in these units and facilities are solitary confinement. Let's see if the shoe fits.
Thank you.
Shore Corridor Collective.
Torture is unequivocally unacceptable under any circumstances.
But what has been unfolding in the shoes is a systematic use of torture by the state for years and decades.
Torture of both minds and bodies.
Of many thousands of prisoners.
To break.
Through the psychological torture of years and decades of isolation.
We call for an end.
We simply could not allow CDCR and/or CCPON, Prison Guards Union,
IGI,
IGU,
OCS,
and SSU to continue to get away with the constant form of warehouse of tens of thousands of prisoners, including the 14,000 plus prisoners held in solitary confinement torture chambers for decades.
We can no longer allow CDCR to use us against each other for their benefit, because the reality is that collectively we are an empowered, mighty force that can positively change this entire corrupt system into a system that actually benefits prisoners and thereby the public as a whole.
The people have the power to change things now.
Know this, our spirit and resolve remain strong, and we know we can count on you all. Together, we can make it happen.
Not only for ourselves, but more importantly, for the generations to come.
With the utmost solidarity, love and respect, onward in struggle, Pelican Bay State Prison, Short Corridor Collective.
Arturo Castellanos, Short Corridor Collective.
Antonio Gideon, Short Corridor Collective.
Sisuwa Natambo Jamal, Slave Name, R.N. Dewberry, Short Corridor Collective.
Todd Ashby, Short Corridor Collective. My name is Todd Ashby. They're never going to let me out. I'm going to die here. I know that. But I have a choice. I can slowly rot, or I can fight. Fight to change things.
Pelican Bay State Prison is a supermax prison in Crescent City, California, explicitly designed to keep California alleged worst of the worst prisoners in long-term solitary confinement. It takes its name from a shallow bay on the Pacific coast, about 2 miles to the west. The prison lies in a detached section of Crescent City that is several miles north of the main urban area.
The heat inside the bus was as stifling as the tension in the surrounding atmosphere. As the bus roared angrily down Highway 101, the transducing drone of the big diesel engine lulled me into reflections of my life.
memories that had soared past me like the scenery flying by outside. The barred, tinted windows of anonymous gray goose, and as swiftly as the life I had led thus far. The restless, dismal chimes of the shackles and chains broke me away from the melancholy spell I had fallen under, and there allowed the sudden realization that the world of oceans, mountains, and landscapes would all soon be but a memory of another lifetime. Looking around me, I found not to be alone in this realization, for the other inmates seemed to be entertaining similar thoughts, though no one dared speak.
What awaited us in the Velikiy Bay Shoe, with its eerily silent corridors, was a purgatory of sorts, a vacuum of uncertainty, sealed off from everything and everyone, a place where one is virtually entombed in a concrete vault, with scarred and pitted walls depicting the idleness, boredom, and in some cases, the lunacy of a previous occupant.
It's a world of its own, where for most, refuge can only be found through a dreamless state of slumber.
There is a look in the shoe's prisoner's eyes that is haunting, a foreboding look from eyes that have themselves stared into the eyes of madness and human cruelty. Eyes that have looked far into the abyss of emptiness, eyes belonging to a species of a lesser god, Hector Gallegos, Pelican Bay State Prison.
Prisoners in the shoe are there for varying lengths of time for various reasons. If one has committed a specific crime or breaks a prison rule, he is given a determined amount of time in administrative segregation. But for those who have been accused of gang affiliation, also known as validation, their sentence is open-ended or indeterminate. Often, the only way for them to get out of the shoe is to debrief. Name others who have gang affiliations.
My name is Sitsuwa Jama, slave name R. N. Newberry, KDK, CDC, has held me in solitary confinement for the past 28 years for my political beliefs and spiritual morality as a new African Revolutionary Nationalist, NARN. If I undergo their debriefing, to which I have refused to do for the past 28 years, and shall not change my mind, I ask myself, what weight does customs hold under the law? For though it may be termed debriefing, using a euphemism does not change what it is. Betraying incompetence, committing an act of treachery for personal gain, considering how our community in the U.S. was brought into being and considering the command and control needs which existed from the get-go. If any community has a historical aversion to stoolies, tacklers, rats and the like, isn't it ours? Therefore, I shall die before my tormentors, KDK, CDC, and or U.S. government, turn this Freedom Friday into a debriefer. I shall never be found among the men of my era.
Before they came to battle, they came to mind. They captured the soul by breaking the spirit with negative thoughts of nothing. Can you cage the thought or capture the wind? It's not the prison guards with guns, but inmates and convicts who refuse to become one. No positive light. The prisoner's cage, the locks of the mind, negativity and self-hate. A refusal to be a positive light, jealous of the next person because he wants to live right. Like a person without sight, darkness into the middle of the night. The real prisons are scales of the mind, locks of negativity standing in place and marking time. Those who try to be a positive thought, ask them why. Is it to hold you back? Without a doubt. But it is the system that caged the back. But first they caged the mind. You hold the key to a positive mentality. Free yourself with positive thoughts. Don't be afraid to dream. Don't let your dream become a nightmare. Negative thoughts are prisoners of the mind, standing in place and marking time. Like the darkness of a soul, the ball of confusion, the truth must be told. Can't you see? Only the truth can make you free. Positive thoughts are headed for the soul. Free the mind and the body will follow. Before they cage the body, they cage the mind. It's not the prison guards with guns, but inmates and convicts who refuse to become one. Negative thoughts are nothing. Taking honey from a bee makes you kill your brother because you fail to see. Look in the mirror and see yourself. You hold the key to a positive mentality. That's the key. So unlock the door and come back to me. Merge with the totality of mentality. Take a vacation from madness and truthful sadness. See the light, hope, and gladness. Days without nights. Can you cage a thought or counter the wind? It's all an illusion, but I'll say it again. Can you cage a thought or counter the wind?
I wonder why everybody think I'm a poet. I'm not a poet. And understand something. I made this gift, and it wasn't meant to be a poem. It was meant to be a statement.
I was in a dungeon at the time when I wrote it. And I just decided to write something about myself and the things, the changes that I was going through, and how I got where I am. Somebody said it was a poem. I said, you gotta be kidding me, it's a statement. Then when I got locked up for it and all of this, it just took off.
They removed my whistle from general population to maximum security. I gained a voice. They removed my voice from maximum security to administrative segregation. My voice gave hope. They removed my voice from administrative segregation to solitary confinement. My voice became vibration for unity. They removed my voice from solitary confinement to the supermax of Camp J. And now, they wish to destroy me. The louder my voice, the deeper they bury me. I said, the louder my voice, the deeper they bury me. Free all political prisoners, the war, the country, common wallet, and your state. The title of this poem is a defining voice. The death is the rim of freedom, and the death I came to freedom, which is a quote by Brian Fanon.
Herman Wallace was a courageous fighter for justice, a political prisoner who this system locked up in conditions of torture in solitary confinement for 41 years. On October 1st, 2013, Herman Wallace was finally freed after a federal judge ruled that his original indictment in the killing of a prison guard had been unconstitutional. 3 days later, on Friday morning, October 4, 2013, Herman Wallace died of cancer in New Orleans. He was 71. This is the reality of isolation.
My name is Jack Morris. The name of this poem is Morning Rain. I awoke to the sound of heavy raindrops pounding down the steel bars of my captivity, only to smell within my memory the sweet scent of freedom being pumped through my cell through an outside vent. The wet glass and smell of moist dirt was in my nostrils, reassuring me that concrete is only a man-made hell to deprive me happiness once taken for granted.
The writer of this letter is a 45-year-old mother of three who was housed in the segregation unit of a New Jersey prison. I never seen the sky, or felt the warmth of the sun, or breeze pass by me, the trees, grass, or a raindrop. I never knew how painful it could be to be denied nature itself. I had a small narrow window, which did not open, and all I could see was brick walls and nothing more. I remember from those brick walls was a small plant growing from within the cracks of the brick. That was the only part of nature that gave me hope. As the wind would blow against the leaf of this plant, I would actually close my eyes and pretend that the wind was blowing against my face. I know it sounds crazy, but it was the only part of nature that I had. Then one day I could not stand it, and I so desperately needed to feel real air, so I started to scrape from the sill of the window with my fingertips. I was determined to make an opening. For 3 months, every day, I scraped and scraped and scraped where my fingers bled, and I managed to make a small opening, and I only had room to place one side of my nose in the opening at a time. And I would take such a deep breath of air. When I was finally able to inhale a very small amount of air, but it was all I needed in order to survive. The officers, they felt sorry for me, and they would bring me a paper and a pen to keep myself busy. Me, I had nothing. And there is when I started to doodle on paper, and from there was how I became an artist. I couldn't draw ever before that time. I couldn't draw a heart to save my life. But after 3 years of the madness of being locked up like an animal, instead of letting it get to me, I put all my pains on paper, and before I knew it, I had art.
My name is Toby Chavez, New Mexican penitentiary. Living life in solitary confinement has been the most horrendous experience I have had to endure in all my 43 years on this earth. I have been in prison for 15 years, 13 of them in solitary confinement. Solitary confinement is designed to dehumanize, cause a person to become dependent, and spiritually break the inmate to the core of his soul. Each and every day that comes and goes takes a piece of humanity away from me, to the point I don't even know who I am. The lack of human contact I have with other inmates is like being thrown into a black hole and completely forgotten. I haven't been able to hug, kiss, or hold a family member in over 14 years. I'm not able to receive visits from my wife or have any type of real quality time with my loved ones. I'm stuck, alone, and have very few words I can speak with other human beings. I'm forced to eat every meal, exercise, and play games by myself. I laugh at myself sometimes because it's the only voice I can hear. My own shadow has literally become my only friend. And if and when I get out and get the opportunity to speak with my wife, mom, and loved ones, I have to put on a mask with a smile because I never want them to see the monster I'm becoming. By the psychological damage created by solitary confinement. I live each day contemplating death, throwing in a towel, just calling it quits. A person can only take so much loneliness.
My name is Michael Bibbs, Pelican Bay State Prison, a view from the shoe. The shoe on the mind is like drowning or being caught in quicksand. When you first realize your plight, you fight fruitlessly with all your might to save yourself. But at some point, you realize that your fate is irreversible, and your ultimate demise only a matter of time. So you let go. Hopelessness sets in. Believing no one can hear you, no one will help you, and no one cares. You are so mentally worn out and emotionally exhausted you cannot help yourself. That sense of helplessness is the vital distress that befalls a long-term shoe prisoner before the cruel and stupid, sadistic part of it all begins the descent into madness. Shoe syndrome is now when you begin to live and adapt to the distorted world of the shoe. In order to survive, exist, one must distort his mind to make an abnormal existence normal. It is the vision of reality. As you must adjust your eyes to light to bring into focus that which is around you, so must a shoe prisoner distort his mind in order to bring into focus his new reality. One cannot hold on to normalcy, for normal in an abnormal world is craziness. This fact is the battle of a shoe prisoner's soul, the death grip of sanity. The irony of it all is that for shoe prisoner to hold on to his sanity, he must embrace, accept his insanity. It has been said for hundreds of years that those whom the gods wish to destroy, first they drive mad. That is the shoe objective.
My name is Daryl Burnett, Pelican Bay State Prisoner. Despite the mental, emotional, and physical challenges of enduring life inside these concrete tombs, based solely on the politics of paranoia and presumption of guilt, my spirit remains undauntedly resilient, free, and strong. I too consider myself progressive and being warehoused inside these modern dungeons for almost four decades does not define my identity nor personhood. I rejected the humanizing, demonizing, and degenerating labels of language that marginalizes my worth as a human being to prove me no more valuable than a chimpanzee or other captive species imprisoned at the city zoo.
Maybe some of you have heard of Dr. Martin Luther King. Did you know that he once said that every step toward the goal of justice requires sacrifice, suffering, struggle, the tireless exertion, passionate concern of dedicated individuals? On many levels, Dr. King would be disappointed, especially when his own life and legacy has been so marginalized as if he was a New Age Santa Claus. He's only relegated to the I Have a Dream speech. He is portrayed as less critical, less challenging, less provocative. He would probably feel betrayed by some of the men who stood shoulder to shoulder with him, but now misuse his name for personal gain and ambitions. No one ever speaks of his position on war, poverty, hunger. He would be disappointed at the indifference, the lack of tolerance, mistrust, fear-mongering, economic inequalities, mass incarceration, economic disparities, homelessness, torture, senseless wars, racial profiling. I think we honor his legacy by continuing his unfinished work.
What about the families of those locked up in those tombs for the living dead? How does being isolated from their loved ones affect them? Many of them do continue to work.
My name is Irene Huerta, and I am the wife of Gabriel Huerta. My husband has been in Pelican Bay Prison for 28 years, and I stand here as a proud wife because he endured all three hunger strikes. I told him that CDC was not going to budge and let us continue to fight. Here we are, continuing the fight, and I want to thank all of the families.
My name is Marie Levin,
My brother is Sinwad Jama, who is in the Shuman Palace today. Today is day 24 of the historic hunger strike of prisoners held in solitary confinement. The five core demands are just human things you and I would respect. In-group punishment and administrative abuse. Abolish the debriefing policy and modify the gang status criteria. Comply with the UN Commission recommendation to end long-term solitary confinement. Provide nutritious food. Create and expand constructive programs.
My name is Georgiana Williams. My oldest son was in the SHU at Pelican Bay. You worry day by day if your child is okay. You can't visit them because they're so far away. They can't call you. All you can do is write them. You wonder if they're alive or dead. And the only thing I can do is pray.
All I have is this pen, this paper, and the truth. I write to you as a survivor of torture, soon to experience more, in hopes that you will use my account as you see fit to shed a light on the use of torture in the United States. When you give your passive consent to your government to torture anyone, you have relinquished power to your government to torture everyone. Your government subjected me to torture. I'm first, you're next.
During one retaliatory stint in segregation, I learned of torture cell 182. I do not know the name of this man who was still in that cell, the cell next to mine. He spoke only broken English. His cell had no bed, he had no toothbrush, no cloth, no soap. The temperature was uncomfortably cold for me with all my clothing and wrapped in a blanket. So the victim in torture cell 182, to keep from experiencing hypothermia, had to pace 24 hours a day, all night, all day, for days. I came back to Mansfield Correctional Center in 2009 and was placed on the gang list for my religious belief. I was taken to a row of cells hidden behind the medical tent. The cell I was placed in had no bed, no mattress, just like my neighbor long ago in torture cell 182. I had to pace 24 hours a day to stay warm. I could not sleep. I survived. Since September, two other of the state's victims have not. I do not know their name, but two prisoners have died on torture cell road since I was fortunate to be removed from there. They died, perhaps pacing the same cold cement floor that I paced. Hour after hour, day after day, feeling 10,000 miles in the mouth of a graveyard. I now face the rest of my life at Supermax, locked in a concrete tomb, dying in complete isolation. I have been approved to be transferred to this torture facility by psychological professionals who affirm that I am sane enough to be driven crazy.
Jerome Gerardo, a mentally ill, homeless military veteran, died in his Riker Island solitary confinement jail cell February 15, 2014. Murdo had been arrested and charged with trespassing. After being discovered sleeping in an enclosed stairwell on the roof of a public housing project in Harlem, according to city officials, Murdo was incarcerated alone in a 6x10-foot cinder block cell at Rikers Island Mental Observation Unit. At about 10:30 p.m. on February 14, 2014, a week later after his arrest, there he was supposed to be monitored every 15 minutes as part of a suicide watch, but he was left unattended for approximately 4 hours. At about 2:30 a.m. the following day, he was discovered slumped over in his bed, already dead. He basically baked to death. Official estimated the temperature in his cell reached over 100 degrees. He died in solitary confinement.
My name is Tanisha Denard. I was arrested at school for getting into a fight and put on probation. Whenever I was late to school, the police would be surrounding our campus giving out policy tickets. After a few times getting tickets, my probation was violated and I was sent to both Juvenile Juvenile Hall. For the first time I entered the gate at Juvenile Hall, I felt anxious and hopeless. I remember the sight and sound of the big, bulky metal wire gate opening up and then shutting behind me. I took showers with the staff watching from the beginning to the end. And there was no curtain on the window, so whenever I see male staff come around, I would always see male staff come around every time I was in the shower the whole time I was locked up. For the first few days, I was very distant. I wouldn't eat or go to the day room, which is a large room where you would sit with other people. I felt unsure and uncomfortable. But instead of trying to counsel me, the probation staff just stopped talking to me. Then they stopped asking if I wanted food or day room time. Even though I wasn't on lockdown, I felt like I was in solitary confinement already. I guess the staff thought I was depressed, so they put me on lockdown for real. No cellmate, no day room time, no hope. The rooms are about 5 by 10 feet with a metal door and a small shadow-proof window that you can see out of until a small part of the hall if you stand on your tiptoes. With the exception of the door, the walls are center block painted white. Some sections of the walls are covered in gang-related tagging and round stains that look like spare feces or blood. Almost everyone is locked up with their shorts and a t-shirt. The air conditioning will be on full blast, so it will always breathe. But once you're in that cell, you will not come out again until it was time to take your 45-second shower 23 hours later. I felt completely unwanted and unnoticed. I started to feel tense when any of the guards would come close to my cell. Paranoid that I had done something wrong, when in reality, I had been with myself for the last 2 to 3 hours of the day. It is by far the worst feeling I've ever experienced. There were also girls in the unit who tried to kill themselves or cut themselves. And there were also women who were locked. You had little or no human contact except when you were raw food or when the nurse brought some people to their bed. I even knew some people who gave beds in their mouths so they could save up to get a stronger high. I believe that cruel and unusual punishment of the shoe made it easier for the whole probation department to treat everyone in juvenile hall this way. Once you get used to locking a person in a cage, it becomes normal to you. You don't even notice how harmful it is, and these conditions start to spread throughout the whole facility. Even for people who weren't on lockdown, nights were under lockdown conditions for everybody. From 8 or 9 p.m. to the next morning, 6 a.m., you are locked to a single person cell that looks exactly like a box. It is also freezing, and if you're found with an extra blanket or a sweatshirt, you're accused of having contraband and punished. We had no books or writing materials, so nice for him. Just you, your thoughts, and the screams of the other young people making words screaming. The sheets and underwear were also often stained with urine, blood, and feces. Just like in the box, people had to beg to use the restroom or were ignored as wanted to shut up, and sometimes refer to pee on the floor or to the towel or your sheet. Your family and community expect that you're safe and unharmed. In reality, you might be safe from other youth, but you're not safe from yourself. Being locked down makes you feel that you're completely worthless to society. You start to think about any ways to escape, even if that means suicide. When I got home, I felt shame. My family couldn't believe my experience, and it constantly made me feel like I was a bad person. That feeling of hopelessness has only increased. I think all young people deserve something better than a 23-hour cell. If we need to heal or calm down, the best thing will be to create a nature park or have us work outside or go to school, take vocational training, so we're ready to start our lives over after the weeks.
Juan Mendez, the UN Special Rapporteur on Torture and Cruel, Inhuman, Degrading Treatment, presented a written report on solitary confinement to the UN General Assembly's Human Rights Committee, which singled out for criticism the routine use of supermax isolation in the United States. Mendez stated,
"I am of the view that juveniles, given their physical and mental immaturity, should never be subjected to solitary confinement."
My name is Davon Williams. I'm a member of the Youth Justice College. During my time in incarceration, I was placed in solitary confinement for 2 weeks, 24 hours a day. I have epilepsy and I had a seizure. The guards were called by my cellmates, but the officers thought I was lying, and they placed me into solitary confinement. From the moment I was put into the hold, I felt isolated and depressed. The room was freezing, it was dirty, and there was no bed. Only a hard concrete seat that was built into the wall. The room was very small. Immediately, I felt trapped and depressed. There was a tiny window in the door that I would peek out of just outside to see out of the claustrophobic cell. One day, the guard caught me looking outside, and he placed a paper over it so I could no longer see anything. I hadn't had a shower for the first 4 days after coming into solitary confinement. I started to smell myself, and I felt disgusting. I received a change of clothes only once during my 2 weeks inside. I was ignored like I did not even exist. After a few days of solitary confinement, I started to feel like I was going crazy. I started to make up stories, started talking to myself. My imagination was blasting. I look back now and I see how creative the mind can be, but also how dangerous it can be. If a person did not have a mental health problem before coming into solitary confinement, spending enough time in there, you would lose your sanity. I had several epileptic seizures while I was in there, because sometimes they did not bring my medicine on time when it was needed, or several times they didn't bring it at all. Stress is one of the main triggers of my seizures. I kept knocking on the door after passing out from having a seizure, but I was ignored. There were no books, no paper, or anything to write on just to address my complete lack of boredom from being in the home. Only 2 or 3 days had passed by, and it felt like a week. I would never know whether it was day or night. Being locked down is traumatizing. As human beings, we were treated worse than caged animals. Everybody deserves to keep their sanity, but I felt like I was slipping away. This is one of the worst experiences of my life, and I wouldn't wish this upon my worst enemy. The cruel punishment of solitary confinement must be eliminated. It would be much better to spend time in effective programs that focus on helping people to grow and change, rather than investing in torture and isolation. Those people such as myself who have experienced solitary confinement must be given the opportunity to present our observations and our solutions. Those most impacted by solitary confinement and our families must be recognized as experts on this issue. Isolation erased our humanity, but we are fighting back so no one can erase our memories.
Representative for the Pelican Bay Shield Corridor, shoot, March 2014.
Last summer, we went on a hunger strike. We were willing to starve ourselves to death rather than continue to endure these dehumanizing conditions forever. We ended the strike because several compassionate legislators promised to call the hearings that are taking place today. Yet today, legislators will hear from psychologists, lawyers, other experts, corrections officials, but not from us, who have the most experience with the conditions we face. Because California CDCR prison officials refuse to let us testify, even remotely, via video or audio.
It is a shame. This new reform effort still maintains the basic conditions at Pelican Bay, and we'll continue to keep prisoners in isolation for vague gang affiliation based on artwork, literature, communications, or informant testimony that does not meet California's judicial standards for reliability in criminal trials.
We have written petitions and letters to the governor, filed a class action federal lawsuit, and gone on hunger strikes seeking real reform. Not the bogus reform California officials now propose. It's time for California to do the right things. It's time for the legislature to enact meaningful reforms.
What a similar alternative to solitary confinement. What can we do right now?
Begin using the Mississippi model, where reform of the classification system led to the significant reduction of Mississippi's solitary confinement population in Mississippi State Penitentiary and Park, leading to significant decreases in violence.
Support mental health alternatives to solitary confinement in jails and prisons, including individuals and group therapy, regular access to psychiatrists, substance abuse counseling, specialized psychiatric service units, discharge planning, and community reentry assistance.
Implement training for correctional officers on how to respond to individuals experiencing psychiatric crises in ways that de-escalate rather than escalate these crises.
Inmates not be placed in isolation longer than 72 hours.
Impose a 7-day limit on supermax stays for inmates being investigated for in-prison crimes.
Stop the brutal cell extractions of uncooperative and often mentally ill inmates.
Use informal sanctions to discipline unruly prisoners, like taking away commissary or recreation privileges, as alternatives to solitary confinement.
Create an independent monitoring board, IMB, consisting of local volunteers who perform inspections of the facility and submit an annual report.
Juveniles, given their physical and mental immaturity, should never be subjected to solitary confinement.
Meet the 5 core demands of the California hunger strike.
A quote by Fyodor Dostoevsky: the degree of civilization in a society can be judged by entering its prisons.
I shall not die 1,000 deaths of compromise, giving up names in exchange for food or blanket. I will bite my own arm to smother my scream and rob you of the satisfaction when you disassemble me. I shall not die shamefully, my chin against my chest, kneeling before the humiliating hole I dug for myself, waiting upon the pistol shot. I will always refuse the blindfold. I shall not die abandoned and alone, obliterated from the memories of those I love. My fate never questioned. Someone will always stand in the rain outside your office window, my name on a cardboard sign. No matter how many times you cut my throat or hang me from my own bed sheet, bludgeon me with your nightstick or fire your bullets into my brain, whether you encircle me in a South African Bantustan or a Coca-Cola factory in Bolivia, or an alley behind the stone wall, or a prison in the heart of it all, I shall not die. 1,000,000 times I shall not die. You will only get my corpse. My name is Sean Swain. All I have is this pen, this paper.
Yo.
And the truth. Please remember that I have lived.
My name is Robert Stockton. This is my poem, Living True.
Suddenly we found ourselves without the world's care, where the cold and desolate embrace our stare.
From endless spaces we walk in chains, and with each passing day it seems less and less strange.
But the wheel that is not broken, only tested in time, we send words to our loved ones.
We're doing just fine. There's nothing to compare it to a small personal life. We do anything to keep away needless tears in their eyes.
Rehabilitation is a castaway, whether young or old, means we're tossed into a place with no hope to hold. To escape, we walk circles under a steel screen, trying to find a way to kiss the sun to be.
We stand alone, arguing what to do.
No one really knows the precious mystery.
Rules will come and rules will go, changing direction like the wind. When you think you've found comfort,
a
new struggle begins.
Some stand